Shivaya Garadha, Shiva Sare Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Shishi Radha Krishna, Go Gopinash, Shyamakunda Radha Kunda, Giri Govardhana Ki Jai. Shri Vrindavan Dhamma Ki Jai, Jagannathpuri Dhamma Ki Jai, Navadvipa Dhamma Ki Jai, Ganga Mai Ki Jai, Jamuna Mai Ki Jai, Bhakti Devi Ki Jai, Tulsi Maharani Ki, Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai, Jai Nitai Gaura Premanande. Oh glorious assembled devotees, oh glorious assembled devotees, oh glorious assembled devotees. Oh glories, Shri Guru and Gauranga. Oh glories, Srila Prabhupada.
Krishna Bhagavan ki
jai.
Radharani ki
jai.
Jai.
Govinda Jaya Jaya Gopala Jaya Jaya
Hare
जयो राधो माधव कुंज बिहारी Jasura Nandana Braj Janaranjana Jasura Nandana Braj Janaranjana Jasura Nandana Braj Janaranjana Janaranjana Jamuna Tihe Ravanachari Jamuna Tihe Ravanachari Jai Radha Madhava Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna
Hare
Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. Prabhupada Tagore Hari Bol Hari Bol Hari Bol Gora Hari Bol
Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parabrajakacharya Stolta Sattva's Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai ISKCON Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai BBT Founder Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai Pramsigaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nichananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasani Gauda Bhakti Vrinda Kita Shishi Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shamakunda Radhakun Giri Govardhana Kija Shri Vrindavan Dham Kija Mayapur Navadvip Dham Kija Ganga Mayi Jamuna Mayi Kija Tulsi Devi Kija Bhakti Devi Kija Their most beautiful lordship Shri Shri Radha Landanishwara Kija Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai Giriraj Maharaj Ki Jai Shri Shri Gornita Ke Harinam Sankirtan Ke Sankirtan Yagya Ke Brihad Madanga Transcendental Book Distribution Ki Jai Nitai Gaura Premanandi All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the lotus feet of Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhali. Shimani Vanda Swami Namo Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhali. Shimani Bhakti Vananda Swami Namo Namo Sikha Swami Namo Namo Sikha Swami Hare Krishna. So welcome everyone. Thank you for being here. In order to hear from the Srimad Bhagavatam. So before I begin, I would like to seek blessings from all the assembled Vaishnavas that you see fit to bestow your mercy upon me so that I can speak something relevant and bona fide from the pages of the Granthararaj Srimad Bhagavatam. Only by the mercy of Vaishnavas is anything possible, so therefore I am seeking your blessings. Hare Krishna. So we'll continue our reading from the 11th canto, the Srimad Bhagavatam. The 11th canto is entitled General History. Haribo. 14 chapters in, we got it. And to this chapter, 14, is entitled Lord Krishna Explains the Yoga System to Uddhava. So continuing with the Uddhava Gita, like that. And today we'll be reading text 11, so 11, 14, 11. So before we begin, please repeat. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Adyanta Vanta Eva Sham. Loka Karma Vinir Mitaha. Dukho Darkas Tamo Nishta. Kshudra Mandaha Suchar Pitaha Ajanta Vanta Evasham Loka Karma Vinir Mitaha Dukho Darkas Tamo Nishta Kshudra Manda Suchar Pitaha Ajanta Vanta Eva Sham Loka Karma Vinir Mitaha Dukodarkas Tamo Nishta Kshudra Manda Suchar Pitaha
Dukha 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 Ladies, please. Word for word. Adiyantavantaha. Possessing a beginning and end. Eva. Undoubtedly. Esham. Of them. The materialistic. Lokaha. Achieved destinations. Karma. By one's material work. Vinirmitaha. Produced. Dukkha. Misery. Udarkaha. Bringing as the future result. Tamaha. Ignorance. Nishtaha. Situated in. Kshudraha. Meager. Mandaha. Wretched. Sucha. With lamentation. Arpitaha. Filled. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki. All the persons I have just mentioned obtain temporary fruits from their material work. Indeed, the meager and miserable situations they achieve bring future unhappiness and are based on ignorance. Even while enjoying the fruits of their work, such persons are filled with lamentation. Purport. Those who have grasped temporary material things, mistaking them to be ultimate reality, are not considered very intelligent by anyone except themselves. Such foolish persons are always in anxiety because by the laws of nature, the very fruits of their work are constantly being transformed in ways neither desired nor expected. The performer of Vedic rituals can elevate himself to heavenly planets, whereas one who is atheistic has the privilege of transferring himself to hell. The entire panorama of material existence is actually uninteresting and dull. Mandaha. One can make no real progress within the material world. Therefore, one should take to Krishna consciousness and prepare oneself to go back home, back to Godhead. Jai. Om Agnati Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshura Militangena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Gena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Garun Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Bitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sabadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Pancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Shivazadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So verse again. Adyantavanta eva sham loka karma vinirmitaha duko darkas tamonishta kshudra manda suchar pitaha. All the persons I have just mentioned obtain temporary fruits from their material work. Indeed, the meager and miserable situations they achieve bring future unhappiness and are based on ignorance. Even while enjoying the fruits of their work, such persons are filled with lamentation. So, as I was reading this, it reminded me of a verse, and that verse reminded me of another verse, and I found myself doing what I really like to do with Srila Prabhupada's books, which is read them and study them. And because I remember when I used to study in the temple room with notebooks, and so many have had, and I used to have Prabhupada's shloka book. And whenever Prabhupada would quote a shloka in the purport, I would go to the shloka book, read the shloka, or if he would cross-reference, you know, from the Bhagavatam, go and get the Bhagavatam and read that verse in purport, and then that would always lead to another verse in purport. And the next thing you know, a whole hour is gone, and you've like been, you know, transmigrating across the spiritual universe, you know, and following Srila Prabhupada's verses. So I thought we could do a little bit of that together, if everyone is okay, and just hear from Srila Prabhupada a little bit, because I really don't have anything useful to say anyway. Because I'm just, you know, pretty useless. So, anyway, so this is a very wonderful verse, making a very important point about the temporary fruits of material work. So it reminded me of verse 5:22 from the Bhagavad Gita, Jahi samsparsha jaboga dukha yonia evata adyantavanta konteya nateshu ramate buddha. An intelligent person does not take part in the sources of misery which are due to contact with the material senses. O son of Kunti, such pleasures have a beginning and an end, and so the wise man does not delight in them. Wise man does not delight in them. Srila Prabhupada's purport. Material sense pleasures are due to contact of the material senses, which are all temporary, because the body itself is temporary. It's such a, I mean, we've heard that. How many times have we heard that statement, right? Jai Shri Shri Radha Nandanishwara Ki, Jai Jagannath Baladev Subhadradevi Ki, Jai Shri Shri Gornita Giriraj Maharaj Ki, Jai. But that verse is, it's so scientific, right? That material sense pleasures you know, our contact with the material senses, and they're all temporary because the senses are temporary. You can't expect lasting pleasure or happiness from something that is temporary. It just doesn't logically make sense because you think it would have to last forever in order to find like happiness, but it's just, that's the facts. A liberated soul, therefore, is not interested in anything which is temporary. Knowing well the joys of transcendental pleasures, how can a liberated soul agree to enjoy false pleasure? In the Padma Purana, it is said, Ramante yogino nante satyanande chid atmani iti rama padena sau param brahma bididyate. The mystics derive unlimited transcendental pleasures from the Absolute Truth. And therefore the Absolute Truth, the Personality of Godhead, is also known as Rama. In the Srimad Bhagavatam also it is said, Nayam deho deha bhajam riloke kastan kaman arhate vidbujam ye tapo divyam putraka yena satvam sudyed yasmad brahma saukyam tvanantam. My dear sons, what's wrong? Disconnected. I've become disconnected. Now it's come back. Now it's disconnected. Now it's come back. Now it's disconnected. It's the state of our existence. Are we all back together again? Okay. My dear sons, there is no reason to labor very hard for sense pleasure. While in this human form of life, such pleasures are available to the stool eaters. Animals is a nice term, but let's be honest. You know, let's go to the lowest of low. To the stool eaters, the hogs. Rather, you should undergo penances in this life by which your existence will be purified. And as a result, you will be able to enjoy unlimited transcendental bliss. Therefore, those who are true yogis are learned transcendentalists, or learned transcendentalists are not attracted by sense pleasures, which are the causes of continuous material existence. The more one is addicted to material pleasures, the more he is entrapped by material miseries. So we become addicted. Any material addicts here? Anyone addicted to the material energy? Okay, I'm not alone. It's important. They say if you're an addict, you need to put yourself in the association of those who recognize it, and we can all light the candle. Yes, I'm an addict. I'm a materialistic addict. I've been desiring for a long time to enjoy in the material world. So this is interesting. So Srila Prabhupada quotes this 551, and he gives a translation here. Then you go to the verse. Da-da-da-da, it's a different translation. Isn't that amazing? It's like when Prabhupada said, devotees asked him, Prabhupada, what book will you do next? And he said, I think I'll do Bhagavad Gita. And they said, Prabhupada, you already did Bhagavad Gita. He said, there are so many commentaries by great authorities. I could do several Bhagavad Gitas as it is. Which kind of challenges the mentality, the Western mentality. Because Bhagavad Gita, as it is, means that's it. Definitive, that's the one and only, lock it down, don't move it, that's it. Right? And Prabhupada said he could write so many different Bhagavad Gitas as it is. Makes you think, huh? So, Prabhupada's translation from the Bhagavatam, 551. Lord Rishabhdev told his sons, so this is from the pastime of Lord Rishabhdev, my dear boys, all of the living entities who have accepted material bodies in this world, of all the living entities who accepted material bodies in this world, one who has been awarded this human form should not work hard day and night simply for sense gratification, which is available even for the dogs and hogs that eat stool. Yeah, there it is. Made sure he got that in. Oh, well, can't speak to you now, Prabhu, sorry. Okay. One should engage in penance and austerity to attain the divine position of devotional service. Sometimes the penance and austerity is just simply staying awake while we read Srila Prabhupada's books. Anyone has that experience? Yeah, okay. By such activity, one's heart is purified, and when one attains this position, he attains eternal, blissful life, which is transcendental to material happiness, and which continues forever. That's what we're looking for, the forever program, not the temporary program. So this is a nice long purport. Will we make it through? Is everyone okay? We continue to read? Yeah? In this verse, Lord Rishabhdev tells his sons about the importance of human life. So we've all got a human body, so it's very important. The word dehabak refers to anyone who accepts a material body, but the living entity who is awarded the human form must act differently from animals. Animals like dogs and hogs enjoy sense gratification by eating stool. After undergoing severe hardships all day, human beings are trying to enjoy themselves at night by eating, drinking, having sex, and sleeping. At the same time, they have to properly defend themselves. However, this is not human civilization. Human life means voluntarily practicing suffering for the advancement of spiritual life. I'll repeat that again. Human life means voluntarily. Anyone been forced to be here? Any non-volunteers? Any prisoners? Okay. All of us are prisoners, yes. By your own device. Human life means voluntarily practicing suffering. Haribol! Wow. And the material energy gives us plenty of opportunities to practice, yes? No? We all have bodies. Bodies are really nice, right? Always work and function properly. Anyone has a body that's giving them some problems? Many of you are young. Body doesn't give much problems when you're young. Mainly it's the senses and the mind. But as you get older, right? Anyone here a little older? Like me? How about you, Mom? Body? Great, isn't it?
Well, that's not voluntary.
No, but it's... Well, we have to go back to the beginning to find out what is voluntary. But you get the opportunity to practice, right? Practice suffering. In one sense, yeah. Human life means voluntarily practicing suffering for the advancement of spiritual life. And Prabhupada explains... There is, of course, suffering in the lives of animals and plants, which are suffering due to their past misdeeds. However, human beings should voluntarily accept suffering in the form of austerities and penances in order to attain the divine life. So it means, like Mother was saying, not just dealing with the body, but actually taking on some voluntary austerity and tapasya, to make spiritual progress. What did Prabhupada say was the tapasya that we take on? The four regulative principles. So just chant 16 rounds and follow the four regulative principles. This is enough tapasya. But there's always more opportunity for tapasya. However, human beings should voluntarily accept in the form of austerities and penances in order to attain the divine life. After attaining the divine life, one can enjoy happiness eternally. So that's what Prabhupada said, just this one life. Just give this one life, right? What is this one life? How many lifetimes have we had? So just give this one life, and the payoff will be immense. Because then you get eternal happiness. Just dedicate this one life. Sounds easy, right? Yeah. After all, every living entity is trying to enjoy happiness, but as long as one is encaged in the material body, he has to suffer different kinds of misery. A higher sense is present in the human form. We should act according to superior advice in order to attain eternal happiness and go back to Godhead. It is significant in this verse that the government and the natural guardian, the father, now when I read this, I looked at the verse and it doesn't mention the government or father or natural guardian. Interesting. Huh? Acha. Okay, thank you. And the?
And his king.
Very good. Should educate subordinates and raise them to Krishna consciousness. Devoid of Krishna consciousness, every living being suffers in this cycle of birth and death perpetually. To relieve them from this bondage and enable them to become blissful and happy, bhakti yoga should be taught. A foolish civilization neglects to teach people how to rise to the platform of bhakti yoga. Without Krishna consciousness, a person is no better than a hog or dog. The instructions of Rishabhdev are very essential at the present moment. People are being educated and trained to work very hard for sense gratification, and there is no sublime aim in life. So people work very hard. Sense gratification is the goal, but there's no understanding of any higher purpose. A man travels to earn his livelihood, leaving home early in the morning, catching a local train, and being packed into a compartment. He has to stand for an hour or two in order to reach his place of business. Then again, he takes a bus to get to the office. At the office, he works hard from 9 to 5. Then he takes 2 or 3 hours to return home. Haribo! Haribo! That's austerity, yes? And he returns home, and then what? After eating, he has sex and goes to sleep. All this hardship, and his only happiness is a little sex. Yan maitunadi grihamedi sukam hituchum. Rishabhdev clearly states that human life is not meant for this kind of existence, which is enjoyed even by the dogs and hogs. Everyone getting the point here? Dogs and hogs, camels and... Indeed, dogs and hogs do not have to work so hard for sex. They don't get on a train, do they? They don't have to work 9 till 5. Just go out in the street. A human being should try to live in a different way and should not try to imitate dogs and hogs. The alternative is mentioned. Human life is meant for tapasya, austerity, and penance. By tapasya, one can get out of the material clutches. When one is situated in Krishna consciousness, devotional service, his happiness is guaranteed eternally. By taking to bhakti yoga, devotional service, one's existence is purified. The living entity is seeking happiness, life after life. But he can make a solution to all his problems simply by practicing bhakti yoga. Then he immediately becomes eligible to return home back to Godhead, as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 4:9. Janma karma cha me divyam evam yoveti tatvataha chaktva deham punar janma naiti mameti so Arjuna. One who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my abode, O Arjuna. Shall we continue the travels, traversing through Srila Prabhupada's purports? So I chose this one, Yan Maitunadi, because it relates directly. Yeah? Yan Maitunadi Grihamedi Sukam Hitucham. Kandu yanena karayor iva dukadukam. Tripyanti neha kripana bahuduka bhaja kandutivan manashijam vishaheta diraha. Sex life is compared to the rubbing of two hands to relieve an itch. I'll never forget when I first came. I was first visiting the temple and coming to classes, and somehow started coming to morning classes. And I think it was Bhakti Tirthamarj gave a class. And he described sex life. Of course, I was a new person, so sex life. What's wrong with sex life, right? And then he said, sex life is like two urinals coming together and rubbing against each other for pleasure. And I thought, I think I'm going to throw up now. And from that point on, the whole conception became manipulated. My brain started to get washed. So, sex life, rubbing of two hands to relieve an itch. Grihamedis, so-called grihastas, who have no spiritual knowledge, think that this itching is the greatest platform of happiness. Although actually, it is a source of distress. The kripanas, the fools who are just the opposite of brahmanas, are not satisfied by repeated sensuous enjoyment. Those who are dhira, however, who are sober and who tolerate this itching, are not subjected to the sufferings of fools and rascals. Everyone okay? Yeah? Materialists think that sexual indulgence is the greatest happiness in this material world, and therefore they make elaborate plans to satisfy their senses, especially the genitals. This is generally found everywhere, specifically found in the Western world, where there are regular arrangements to satisfy sex life in different ways. And Prabhupada says here, especially in the Western world, but I remember in one lecture, I think it was, one senior devotee, he made the point that, well, it's also in India. I mean, you don't get a country with over 1 billion people not engaging in sex life. So it's prominent everywhere, even amongst those who should be following the Vedic culture. Actually, however, this has not made anyone happy. Even the hippies, who have given up all the materialistic comforts of their fathers and grandfathers, cannot give up the sensual happiness of sex life. Such persons are described here as kripanas, misers. The human form of life is a great asset, for in this life one can fulfill the goal of existence. Unfortunately, however, because of a lack of education and culture, people are victimized by the false happiness of sex life. Prahlad Maharaj therefore advises one not to be misled by this civilization of sense gratification, and especially not by sex life. Rather, one should be sober, avoid sense gratification, and be Krishna conscious. The lusty person who is compared to a foolish miser never gets happiness by sense gratification. The influence of material nature is very difficult to surpass. But as stated by Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, Mameva prapadyante mayamitam tarantite, if one voluntarily submits to the lotus feet of Krishna, he can be saved very easily. In the reference to the low-grade happiness of sex life, Jamunacharya says in this connection, Yadavadi mam cheta Krishna padara vinde nava nava rasa dam anudya tarantam asit tadavadi bata nari sangame smaryamane bhavati muka vikara shushtu nishtivanam cha. Since I have been engaged in the transcendental loving service of Krishna, realizing ever new pleasure in Him, Whenever I think of sex pleasure, I spit at the thought. Srila Prabhupada used to say, I spite at the thought. And my lips curl with distaste. Jamunacharya had formerly been a great king who enjoyed sexual happiness in various ways. But since he later engaged himself in the service of the Lord, he enjoyed spiritual bliss and hated to think of sex life. If sexual thoughts came to him, he would spit with disgust. So important point here also that even we may make advancement, Jamunacharya was a great personality, but still the thoughts may come, but didn't act on them. Now whether he actually turned every time and spat, you know, or whether it's a principle that, you know, otherwise we might all need to get a little spittoon. I forget what it says, like, on a man's mind, sex life crosses a man's mind like every 10 seconds or something crazy like that. And so we'd probably fill up a lot of spit bottles around. So, but I think the principle is that we, you know, remove our mind from it and, you know, it becomes very distasteful. So, this, because there was one verse we could follow, but it reminded me of another verse. Oh, what happened? It's disappeared. Which was, which verse was it? Oh, I did look it up. No, not that one. What is it? Oh. No. No. Good thought. Yes, you could go that direction. But I thought of this one. Vishyavinivartante nirharasha dihinaha rasavarjam rasopyashwa param drishtva navartate. The embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, but the taste for sense objects still remains. But ceasing such engagements by experiencing a higher taste. And prasadam will be in 7 minutes, so we can meditate on that. Then he becomes fixed in consciousness. So I'll just read this. Unless one is transcendentally situated, it is not possible to cease from sense enjoyment. The process of restriction from sense enjoyment by rules and regulations is something like restricting a diseased person from certain types of eatables. The patient, however, neither likes such restrictions nor loses his taste for the eatables. Similarly, sense restriction by some spiritual process like Astanga Yoga in the matter of yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, etc., is recommended for less intelligent persons who have no better knowledge. But one who has tasted the beauty of the Supreme Lord Krishna, in the course of his advancement in Krishna consciousness, no longer has a taste for dead material things. Therefore, restrictions are there for the less intelligent neophytes in the spiritual advancement of life. But such restrictions are only good until one actually has a taste for Krishna consciousness. When one is actually Krishna conscious, he automatically loses his taste for pale things. Jai Srila Prabhupada ki. Anyone has any comments, questions? Yes, Mother, is there a mic? Mike, get on the mic, Mike.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Two things. One, Sorry, thank you as well. This morning you mentioned about Srila Prabhupada said he could write multiple commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita.
Mm-hmm.
Some people have mentioned to me that, oh, you know, you're only following a philosophy that is technically an interpretation from somebody. Mm-hmm. So why is that process better than another if you're actually just taking the interpretation of somebody? But the only way that I could figure to contract that was to say, well, that may be true. It is an interpretation to a degree, but the process works.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore it's bona fide. What would you say about that, please?
Well, I mean, the principle of interpretation, I guess you could say, is there. But Srila Prabhupada is coming in the disciplic succession from spiritual master to disciple to spiritual master to disciple. So he's not just making it up. And that's most people's idea of interpretation. I mean, so he's just making up his thing. But it's not. It's a long lineage of persons who have understood a spiritual, scientific spiritual process that works. So he's not just making it up. It's not just his interpretation. This is thousands of years of understanding coming in a line of disciplic succession directly from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So it's not interpretation. That's what I would say. Anyone else would like to answer? Mother, you have an answer? You should try to read it. Yeah, simple answer. Proof is in the pudding. Proof of the pudding is in the eating. Yes, Prabhu?
So Prabhupada said that my only qualification, my only credit is that I haven't changed
anything. Yeah. So it's, again, that principle that has been passed down from one teacher to disciple all the way back to the beginning of its inception. Mm-hmm. So like that. Yes, Mother?
Mm-hmm. That's okay.
Is this on what she said or is on the class? Okay, yep. Yeah.
In relation to the quotation from Yamunacharya, another important point from that is that he says he spits at the thought of sex life, so we should spit at the thought and not spit at the woman or, you know.
Yeah. Very nice. Thank you.
Some senior devotees were one time speaking on this verse, and they said that some devotees actually started doing that. You know, they would see an attractive woman and, you know, spit in the general direction.
So yeah.
The point is that we shouldn't see that person who, let's say, you know, evokes our sex desire as the problem. The problem is our own lust.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we should be spitting on.
Yeah. So spit on yourself. Yeah. And everybody hates that, right? Every time you go to spit, you're like, oh, man. No, it's a very good point. And those who were in the class last night, there were a lot of points brought up about misunderstandings and so many different things that happen over time. So thank you. Very, very important point to make, yes. Anyone else? Someone else had their hand? Yes, Prabhu.
So human life is voluntarily accepting suffering for spiritual realization, right?
Yes, very nice.
Can you explain to me how singing and dancing is suffering?
No, singing and dancing is the happiness.
Yeah, but that's for spiritual realization.
Yes, but I guess in one sense, well, you can come every day at 4:30 a.m.
Eventually.
No, the point is, like, devotees, once they came and they made a statement to Prabhupada, you know, 4:30, we're really tired. We don't feel like singing and dancing. And you want us all to sing and dance at 4:30 in the morning. And he said, anyway, just pretend, just start to move your feet as if you're happy to dance, and eventually it'll, you know, you'll happen. So the point is that we experience bliss from it, but have you also ever seen some people that in the kirtan they're like not moving. There are people that for them to dance is like, ah, never, I cannot do this, you know. From whatever background they may be, but some people singing and dancing. You go on the Harinam, it's not that everyone just automatically starts singing and dancing. So we experience it as bliss, not as a tapasya, but there may be other things that we consider like a tapasya, like fasting on Ekadasi or fasting on Jamashtami, or chanting 16 rounds every day, or, as we said earlier, following the four regulative principles. That's a tapasya. But the chanting and dancing, in one sense, in kirtan, is like an outpouring of just pure bliss. But for some people, that's also an austerity or a tapasya. Well, yes, Prabhu?
In the past, like in Satyuga, Tretyuga, they didn't have this Sankirtana movement.
That's right, yeah.
Higher austerities, which is probably the
possible. Okay. I disagree with that statement. Because Narada Muni has been chanting since forever.
Yeah.
So chanting and dancing has existed forever.
Well, it's existed forever. But as far as the given process in each age, there are different processes. So like that. So there may have been something that predominated that wasn't that. And Jagat Palanpur is in the room, so I'm presuming you want to say something? Okay.
Can I go back to the issue of interpretation?
The issue of interpretation? Yeah, please, please.
When Sarvabhoma Bhattacharya was preaching to Lord Chaitanya, say, come, I'll teach you Vedanta. And he spoke for 1 week, and he says, well, you're not asking any question. You ask Lord Chaitanya, why don't you ask any question? I told you so many things. Do you understand any other things? That?
No.
And Lord Chaitanya made this point to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. He says, your interpretation of
Vedanta.
Of Vedanta is unintelligible to me. It makes no sense. And he used this term, which is very important terms, with regard to the issue of interpretation. He says, the Vedas, Vedanta, is swatapramanam, is self-explanatory.
Okay.
You don't need to do any interpretation. Swatapramana is self-explanatory. You need to have the mukhya vritti, the face. I guess modern expression is like face value, or mukha means face. You have to take it as it is without need of interpretation. It is self-explanatory. Why Lord Chaitanya told, why are you giving all these twists? It's just there, self-explanatory. Just take it as it comes. And then to qualify further the statement, it says, sometimes when we study scripture, there is the need of interpretation. Well, sometimes some statement are not self-evident, and then you have to go. You need to apply the gonavritti approach, which is you have to try some interpretation. But by and large, it's mukavritti. You can see it's self-explanatory. There's no need to provide any type of interpretation.
Nice. Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you. Okay. Something?
In relation to Prabhu's point about kirtan and how chanting and dancing is an austerity?
Is or isn't?
Is.
Well, okay.
Because
yeah.
he was saying,
it
how
isn't.
Is this austerity?
Yeah.
How it is, is that because it's sankirtan. So this is not my own experience, but I took Bhakti Vai Bhava class in Mayapur, and all the devotees seem to agree on this point, that one of the biggest austerities in ISKCON is living with devotees. So
sacrilege.
So then,
how dare you say such a...
So then, if that's true, then the austerity is not the kirtan, it's the san. San kirtan, because congregational chant, we have to be in sangha. So the
nice.
Sangha can sometimes be an austerity, but the process in this age is sankirtan. We don't chant alone.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah, lots of times devotees are happy to chant their rounds, but not in the temple room with everybody else. You know, please. You know, I have to crawl under a desk and a table and chant my rounds of mana or be in the kirtan. Oh, I don't like when this person leads kirtan. It's also another thing. And that one's playing, Kartel's too loud, and that one plays like this. It's, we're perpetually being challenged to overcome our own inebrieties. Anyway, thank you, very nice. Okay, last point, because we're already over time.
I just wanted to add to the Prabhu that said about the suffering, that the process definitely works in terms of like what we perceive to be suffering is actually liberation, because I remember when I was working and I had to go and deliver books to a prison, and I'd spent my whole life being terrified of the idea of prisons, and all of a sudden I was like counting down the minutes until I could finish work so I could go and deliver these books. And so it's like something that you would consider to be absolute suffering is actually like I couldn't wait. And even cooking, you know, like cooking in a regular kitchen, you're suffering so much. But running around in the kitchen downstairs, and you're totally on the point, you know. But it's like, it's totally worth it. And then you just really feel bliss afterwards.
Mm. Very nice. Thank you, Mother. Okay, Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki. Grantaraj Shima Bhagavatam ki. Ananta Kodi Vaishnavrinda ki. Jayanatai Go Premanandi. Or Bhakta Vrinda ki. Jai. Okay, so for the pleasure of the lordships, we have some Sankirtan scores. Any book distribution scores? Okay. So, yesterday in Radha's Boutique, we distributed 10 books for 133 Lakshmi points. And in Closet Krishna yesterday, they distributed one small book, three medium books, one maha big book for 250 Lakshmi points. And in Govinda's restaurant, we distributed prasadam to at least 259 customers for a total of 2,341 Lakshmi points. Transcendental prasadam distribution key. Okay, so let's see. We just need some volunteers to help serve breakfast prasadam this morning. On the ladies' side, one. Okay. And on the men's side, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Okay, great. And to help clean up the temple room after breakfast prasad. One, two, okay. So offer our prayer to their most beautiful lordships. Dear Shri Shri Radha Landanishwar, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra, Shri Shri Gauranitai, and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. With a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect a holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada, for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, the surrendered servants of your servants, humbly beg. New temple for the lordships, ki jai, Srila Prabhupada, ki jai. So if everyone could please help to bring the prasadam up, can serve out and get on with the day's activities. Hare Krishna.